Okay, dear students, yesterday we have studied about the various types of or optical isomerism. We have seen that the optical isomers, they rotate the plane of plane polarized light into the clockwise or anticlockwise direction, and when they do it, they can be considered as a dextrorotatory or revorotatory, and they can be assigned the sign plus and minus. For that we need a chirality or a chiral carbon in the compound. A compound which is having a chiral carbon should have a carbon with which all the atoms or group of atoms are bonded, with which they are not same, and if it is so, then the mirror image of that compound cannot be superimposed, and this kind of compound or this kind of compound is known as the chiral compound, and such carbon is known as chiral carbon. Chirality is the basic necessity for optical isomerism. So a chiral compound may or may not be optical isomer, but if there is no chiral carbon present in the compound is never going to be optically active. In that case, if there is plane of symmetry or center of symmetry, we can say that the compound cannot be optically active. We have even studied about the lateral inversion in our previous classes. So stereoisomers are the optically active compounds which have different arrangement into the space or three dimension. Now we need to know about the enantiomers. So enantiomers are the stereoisomers which are optically active, and they are the mirror image of each other. So I have written the definition for enantiomers. Optically active stereoisomers, that means the structures of same compound with different arrangement in space or three dimension, who are mirror image of each other, are called enantiomers, and enantiomers have the chiral carbon. Then we have studied about the, like, being optically active, both enantiomers rotate the plane of polarized light. If one enantiomer rotated clockwise, another rotate the plane of polarized light anticlockwise. So if one enantiomer is D or dextrorotatory or positive, then the other must be L or negative or levorotatory. You can see here we have a compound which is known as the 2,3 dihydroxypropanol. This 2,3 dihydroxypropanol, if one we put it L, then the other should be D, and when we put L, it should be minus, or it should be rotating into the anticlockwise, and plus should, sorry dear students, plus should rotate it into the clockwise manner. Levorotatory rotate the plane of polarized light in anticlockwise manner, and dextrorotatory rotate the plane of polarized light into the clockwise manner. So this is how, my dear students, we understand. Enantiomers have some physical properties. Enantiomers have same physical properties. These enantiomers have same melting point, same boiling point, same refractive index. Enantiomers only differentiate only in the form of, or only in the case where they have they rotate the plane of polarized light in a different direction. So now, my dear students, if you have any doubt, you can ask me, or we can move to the next part. Do you have any doubt to ask, my dear students? You can ask me. Do you have anything to ask? Is there anything which you cannot understand? Okay. Okay, then let's move to the next part. Let us understand about the racemic mixture. A mixture that contains 50% plus or D and 50% minus or L enantiomers, that is two enantiomers in equal proportion, such mixture is called racemic mixture. Racemic mixture is optically inactive because 50% of D and 50% of L, 50% of L rotate the light in anticlockwise manner. In the same proportion, other 50% D will rotate the light in clockwise manner, that is in the opposite direction, and ultimately that results into the zero final rotation in polarimeter, and that is why this racemic mixture is not optically active. Racemic modification. To obtain an optically inactive substance, 50% positive or D and 50% negative or L stereoisomers are mixed. Such mixture is optically inactive, and it is called racemic modification. Now, what is racemization? The process of conversion of enantiomers into racemic mixture is known as racemization. Once again, the process of conversion of enantiomers into the racemic mixture, that is 50% positive and 50% negative, is known as racemization. Now, my dear students, we want to study about the diastereomers. Diastereomers are the structures of the same compounds. They differ by the arrangement of atoms or groups in a space, that is, they are stereoisomers, but they are not the mirror image of each other, and they are optically active. Now, it is interesting to know, my dear students, that diastereomers are the compound, or diastereomers are the structures of the same compound. They are even optically active, but they are not the mirror image of each other. So let us understand diastereomers looking at some example. Let's have a look to the examples of the diastereomers. Optically active structures of the same compound differ in arrangement of atoms or group of atoms in space. Again, you know, we are just following the same definition. That is the definition for enantiomers. Optically active structures of the same compound differs in arrangement of atoms or group of atoms in space. That is, they are the stereoisomers, but which are not the mirror image of each other are called stereoisomers. If they are not stereoisomers, but they are called diastereomers. Here we should write diastereomers instead of stereoisomers, my dear students. We should write here diastereomers instead of stereoisomer. Here it should be written as a diastereomers. Please make the required correction into your book also. They are called diastereomers. So these diastereomers are not the mirror image. They are not the mirror image of each other. That is the only difference we can see about them, that they are not the mirror image. So this is how they differ with the enantiomers. Enantiomers are the mirror image of each other. Diastereomers are not the mirror image of each other. This is how, my dear students, we study about the diastereomers and enantiomers. Now let us look at the example so that we can understand it better. 2,3-dichloropentane. 2,3-dichloropentane has various arrangement of atoms in the space possible. Let us look at the various arrangement of 2,3-dichloropentane. This is the structure of 2,3-dichloropentane. On second carbon we have chlorine, on third carbon we have chlorine, and total there are 5 carbons. So what are the various arrangement that are possible for this? Let us look at. You can see the 4 structures here. These all 4 structures belong to the same compound, and that compound is 2,3-dichloropentane. You can see this is the second carbon and this is the third carbon, and on both second and third carbon there is chlorine present, total 5 carbons. So this structure 1 and structure 2 are the mirror image of each other. This structure 2 and structure 3 are the mirror image of each other. But remember, the 1 is not the mirror image of 4, 1 is not the mirror image of 3. Same way, 2 is not the mirror image of 4, 2 is not the mirror image of 3, but still all these 4 represents 2,3-dichloro. All these 4 represents 2,3-dichloropentane, and all these 4 are optically active because they have this chiral carbon present with them. Carbon number 2 and carbon number 3 are always the chiral carbon in all these 4 structures. So my dear students, you can say that 1 and 2 are the enantiomers. 1 and 2 are the enantiomers, my dear students. 3 and 4, they are the enantiomers. But 1 with 3, they are diastereomers. 1 with 4, they are diastereomers. 2 with 3, they are diastereomers. And 2 with 4, they are diastereomers. Why are they diastereomers? Because they represent the same compound, they are optically active, they have different kind of arrangement of atoms or group of atoms in the 3 dimension, but they are not the mirror image of each other, but they represent the same compound. And as they are not the mirror image, they are known as the diastereomers, and that is why for the same compound 2,3-dichloropentane we can have the structures like we have seen all the 4 structures, and now we realize that all the 4 structures represent 2,3-dichloropentane. All the 4 structures represent 2,3-dichloropentane. They differ by the arrangement of atoms or group of atoms in the space or 3 dimension. First and second are the mirror images of each other. Third and four are the mirror images of each other. But 1 and 2 represent same compound, differ in the arrangement of atoms or group of atoms in the space, that is, they are the stereoisomers, but are not mirror images. So when we look at these structures, we realize, my dear students, same way 1 and 4 are stereoisomers, but not the mirror image of each other. 2 and 3 are, and 2 and 4 are even representation of the same compound, but they are not the, but they are, and they are the stereoisomers, but they are not the mirror image of each other. So my dear students, we can easily say that 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 are the enantiomers, but 1 and 3, 1 and 4, 2 and 3, 2 and 4, they are called the diastereomers, and they are optically active. These diastereomers are also optically active. Now we want to study about a new kind of compound, which is known as the meso compound. Let us understand the definition of the meso compound. Meso compound is a compound that has chiral carbon. Remember, meso compound has chiral carbon. Meso compound is a compound that has chiral carbon, but the compound itself is achiral. That means the compound itself is not optically active. And why it is not optically active? Because it has plane of symmetry. It has plane of symmetry inside it. Let us take the example of C2,3-dichlorobutane. See, it has 4 carbon. On 2nd and 3rd carbon, both the chlorine atoms are present and the same sign. And that is why we use the word cis for this kind of compound. So let us have a look at the structure of this compound. You can see the structure of C2,3-dichloropentane, my dear students, and you will realize that yes, this is the structure, that it has got a plane of symmetry. When you cut it from here, or if you put a mirror here, then the upper part and the lower part are exactly the same. The compound itself has a plane of symmetry, and upper part of the mirror and lower part of the mirror are the same, or are the mirror image of each other. And that is why if upper part rotate the light or plane of polarized light into clockwise manner, then the lower part will rotate it into the anti-clockwise manner. Overall, both rotated equally in opposite direction and the final rotation would be zero. So this compound is a chiral. Cis-2,3-dichlorobutane has a plane of symmetry due to which half of the compound rotate like clockwise while half of the compound rotate like anticlockwise. And finally, my dear students, we realize that and final rotation is zero. So cis-2,3-dichlorobutane has two chiral carbon, but the compound itself is a chiral. But now think about the another one, which is known as the trans-2,3-dichlorobutane. In this trans-2,3-dichlorobutane, you can see that both the chlorines are present at the opposite side. So we cannot generate a plane here, or if we put a mirror here, we can realize that there is nothing, or they are not the mirror images of each other. And that is why it does not have plane of symmetry, and that is why this trans compound, where the same compound but which is the trans isomer, the trans-2,3-dichlorobutane is optically active and it is not a meso compound. So this is how, my dear students, we understand about the meso compound. When we started studying about the chirality, we have discussed that there are compounds which have chiral carbon, but they do not have chirality. So meso compounds are such compounds which have the chiral carbon, but they are achiral, they do not show optical activity. Now let us solve some problems. Identify chiral and achiral molecule in each of the following pair of compound. You can see, my dear students, here that all the atoms or group of atoms bonded here are different from each other, and that is why when we draw the mirror image of each other, the mirror images are non-superimposable, and that is why we can say that this compound is chiral compound. So the first compound that we have got is chiral compound, and we can prove the chirality. It is chiral because all the atoms on groups bonded to the carbon are different. But when we look at the next one, we can see that there are two same group bonded to this carbon, and that is why it is achiral. Now this is the carbon that we are going to study about. You can see that here it is CH3, here it is CH3, CH2, CH2, here it is OH and H. So all the group bonded to this carbon are not identical, and that is why it is a chiral compound. Let's look at the next question, my dear students. Look at this one. This is the carbon that we are going to study. It has these two very similar. So this is CH3, CH2, this is even CH3, CH2. So both the methyl group, two identical ethyl groups are present, and that is why it is achiral. Same way, my dear students, when we look at this carbon, you can see that first one is hydrogen bonded with it, then we have bromine, then this side we have CH3, and this side we have CH3, CH2. So I have represented this carbon here, which have all the four atoms or group of atoms bonded to it are not identical. No two atoms are identical, and that is why it is not achiral, but it is chiral. I made a mistake here. It is actually a chiral compound. Okay, then let's go to the next one. This is achiral because you can see all these carbons have at least H2 with them. So at least two hydrogen bonded with them, and that is why it is achiral. Now let us understand few phenomena which is known as the inversion, retention and racemization with some example, my dear students. Let's look at this reaction which I am going to show you here. You can see that this is the original compound. This original compound reacts with the nucleophile Y. When this original compound reacts with this nucleophile Y, there are three possibilities, my dear students. The first possibility is that Y attack this carbon and replace this oxygen without changing the position of any of this atom or group of atoms. So you can see that C2H5 is at its own position. Hydrogen is also in the same position. As you can see here, hydrogen is even in the same position. And CH3 is even on the right side of this carbon. Only this X is being replaced by Y, and we get this product. So this is what it is known as the retention. But now if you look at the second possibility, you will find that this H is rotated to 180 degree. This CH3, which was on the right side, has come to the left side. This X, which was on the left side, came to the right side. So from this, if we get this product, there is a rotation of 180 degree. And this 180 degree rotation cause a particular situation which is known as the inversion. But sometime what happens, my dear students, that this Y sometime attacks from either this side and make 50% of the product, or Y may come and attack from this side and make 50% of the product. So when this type of attack is there, the 50% product is made. When this type of attack is there, 50% product is made like B, because there is retention or there is inversion, because Y will be on the other side. And if it is there, if it is attacked from this side, then Y will replace X in the same side, and then you will have 50% of A. So the third possibility says that there will be 50% retention and 50% inversion, and we will get the mixture of the product. This process is known as the racemization, my dear students. So my dear students, you can understand the inversion, retention and racemization same at the same time as an option of three possibilities. So when this compound is attacked by a nucleophile Y, there are three possibilities. The arrangement in the space of various atoms or group of atoms does not change, only X is replaced or substituted by Y. Such process is known as the retention, and product A is from the retention. Possibility two, that the spatial arrangement is changed during the chemical reaction called nucleophilic substitution, and molecule takes a rotation of 180 degree after the reaction. Such phenomena is called inversion, and the geometry turns inside out. A rotation of 180 degree cause inversion. Note, inversion not necessarily change the direction of optical rotation too. It is not even sure that retention will keep the direction of optical rotation same. That means it is not necessary that retention will keep minus to minus, and it is not necessary that the retention will keep plus to plus, or it is not necessary that minus will be turned to plus if there is inversion. It is not even sure that minus will remain minus during the inversion. So it has, the positive and negative sign has nothing to do with this process of retention and inversion. Now when you look at this, this A, B, D and C, they are changed their direction with a 180 degree rotation, and this is how the inversion takes place. In SN2 mechanism, there is inversion takes place. But in SN1 or SN2, neither of these have retention with them. Now looks at the possibility 3, neither A nor B, but 50. Possibility 3 is neither A nor B, but 50% A and 50% B kind of product is formed, which is optically inactive product. Such process is called racemization. In SN1 mechanism, my dear students, we have already studied that in SN1 mechanism, racemization takes place. That means reactant may be plus or D, reactant may be plus or dextrorotatory, may be minus or levorotatory. Product will be definitely plus or minus or the racemic mixtures for sure. And the product is optically inactive because racemic mixtures are optically inactive. So when, now we'll see the same with the example. When minus 2, you can look at this reaction, my dear students, that when minus 2 methyl butane 1-ol reacts with HCl, it will give us plus 1 chloro 2 methyl butane. But you can see that this OH and this Cl, they are present at the same side of the carbon. That means here there is retention. Here the retention took place, but the positive and negative sign are changed. Configuration is inverted when minus 2, when the above reaction takes place. Same way, configuration is inverted when minus 2 bromo octane is allowed to react with sodium hydroxide and it gives us plus octane 2-ol. You can see here minus 2 bromo octane, where Br is on the right side, will give us the product when OH is on the left side. So here it is inversion. But you can see that in inversion, the minus product has turned into plus product. But that is what it is not always necessary. Optically active plus or minus 2 bromobutane will always give plus or minus butane 2-ol when allowed to react with OH minus or nucleophile following the SN1 mechanism. You can see, my dear students, that this compound, which is, you know, 2-bromopentane, in the first slow step, it forms the carbocation, and in the second step, the OH minus ion attacks from both the sides, 50% from this side and 50% from the opposite side, and we get a racemic mixture of 50-50% dextro and levo. Now, my dear students, we want to study about elimination reaction. So, elimination reactions, to understand the elimination reaction, first we should study the alpha beta carbon molecules. So, what is the alpha carbon? So, the halogen atom directly bonded to a carbon, such carbon is known as alpha carbon. You can see, my dear students, that there are three various kinds of alpha carbon I have encircled here for you. This alpha carbon will definitely have halogen directly bonded to it or the functional group present with it. Then the next carbon or the adjacent carbon or the neighboring carbon of that alpha carbon is known as beta carbon. So here we have one beta carbon, here we can see two beta carbons, and here we can see three beta carbon, 1, 2, and 3 beta carbon present. So the carbon adjacent to the alpha carbon are known as the beta carbons. This is what you should know about the alpha and beta carbons. Now, elimination or dehydrohalogenation. When a haloalkane with beta hydrogen atom is heated with alcoholic sodium or potassium hydroxide, there is elimination of hydrogen atom from beta carbon and halogen atom from the alpha carbon. This is what you can see it easily, my dear students, that here on the alpha carbon we have a halogen X, on beta carbon we have hydrogen. This base attacks on the hydrogen and remove this hydrogen with base. The bond, the electron of this bond goes to make a double bond, and the bond of this bond is CX bond goes with the chlorine of gold, goes with the halogen, and halogen makes a halide ion. We combine with H and make BH, and from this alkyl halide we get an alkene, with the double bond between the two carbon, that is the double bond here. In this case, the double bond is between the alpha and beta carbon. You can see, my dear students. So as a result, an alkene is formed as a product. Since beta hydrogen atom is involved in this reaction, the reaction is known as the beta elimination reaction.